I first came across this question on Reddit when I was looking for a video to put on Pi Day. This puzzle brings together several beautiful topics of math, from recursion to linear algebra to graph theory, and ultimately a little bit of pi into the equation. Let's read the question. Consider an m by n grid. Let's consider 2x1 dominoes. A tiling is defined as some placement of these dominoes that covers every single square on the grid with no overlaps and no diagonal placements and no protrusions. For example, this is a tiling and this is not a tiling. The question is pretty straightforward. How many possible ways can you do this? More formally, given an m by n grid, how many possible ways can you arrange or tile 2x1 dominoes on the grid? Well, how do we even approach this problem? But as with a lot of math problems, let's first think of a simpler case and then build up to the actual problem. So first let's consider, for what m and n does a tiling of 2x1 dominoes even exist? Well, it's easy to say that if any of the two dimensions is an even number, we can just cover the whole column with 2x1 dominoes and repeat for every row. To generalize, we can just say that a tiling exists when m times n is even. Now let's consider a simpler case for the original question. If m is equal to 2, how many possible ways can you tile 2x1 dominoes? This question can be easily answered through the use of recursion. To make sure we're all on the same page about recursion, let's consider a classic example, the Fibonacci sequence. Recursion just means that the output of a function is dependent on the function itself. So the Fibonacci function is defined as follows. So the first two numbers are 1 and 1, and given the two previous numbers, we add them together to get the next number. So we can write the nth Fibonacci number, f of n, as f of n minus 1 plus f of n minus 2, given that f of 1 is equal to 1 and f of 2 is equal to 1. So let's get back to the original question. Let's define a function t of m, n, which takes in m and n, the dimensions of our grid, and outputs the number of ways we can arrange 2x1 dominoes on the grid. If you remember, we're looking at the case where m is equal to 2, so let's find t of 2, n. Since we know we're going to try to find a recursive form, let's consider the two cases. The first case is when we have one domino arranged vertically, like this. So in this case, the number of ways to tile a 2x n board with the last row having a vertical domino is just the number of ways to tile a 2x n-1 board. But what if we arrange the dominoes horizontally? So now we're looking at a 2x n-2 board. So the number of ways to tile a 2x n board with the last two rows having horizontal dominoes is just the number of ways to tile a 2x n-2 board. And so we have the formula t of 2, n is equal to t of 2, n-1 plus t of 2, n-2. Does this look familiar? Recall, we have t of 2, 1 is equal to 1 and t of 2, 2 is equal to 2. This is just the n plus first Fibonacci number. Now, here's where the real problem starts. How do we generalize this? Let's consider a 4x4 board. There's just too many ways to get the recursive solution, and this just becomes an infeasible case for any m by n. Let's take a different approach to this. The computer scientists among you might have thought of some sort of dynamic programming, which you're kind of right, but let's first use some graph theory and linear algebra. Let's consider our board. Instead of looking at it as having tiles, let's consider each tile to be a vertex and each tile is connected through edges to the other tiles around it. What is this? This is just a graph. And by definition, a graph is just a collection of edges and vertices. It's a common data structure which we use in computer science and chemistry, physics, so many other fields. Here, we have an edge between each tile and its neighboring tiles. So the question is rephrased to, how many different combinations of edges can we choose such that every single vertex is covered? In graph theory, we call this a perfect matching of a graph. And another important graph is bipartite graphs. Simply put, this just means that we can have some vertices on one side, that are unconnected, and these vertices are connected to another group of vertices on the other side who are unconnected. And you can see this by the diagram I've made on the screen. Now let's consider the following question. Is our grid graph bipartite? Well, let's think of a grid as a chessboard and label each vertex as black or white. Notice, each vertex is only connected to a vertex of an opposite color. And so we can make all of the black vertices on one side and all the white vertices on another side. This makes our graph bipartite. Let's look at some more terminology. Each half of a bipartite graph is called a part of a graph. And thus we have two parts to our grid graph, our black part and our white part. And each part has half of the total vertices, so mn by two vertices. So now that we have our graph, let's move on to something else. Let's try to construct an adjacency matrix. Before I talk about that, we have to number out our vertices. The order doesn't really have an impact on the solution of the problem, but let's go on the traditional snake way like we do in geometry. So let's just consider the case where we have three vertices on the left side and three vertices on the right side connected like this. So our adjacency matrix has size n by m, and n and m are both the number of vertices in each part of our graph. So in this case, we have three on one side and three on the other, so the dimensions of our matrix is 3 by 3. And the adjacency matrix can either contain ones or zeros. The value a of ij is 1 if the edge I in the first group has a connection with the edge j in the second group. So in this case, the value a of 1, 1 is 0, since there's no connection between the first vertex of the first group and the first vertex of the second group. The value a of 1, 2 is 1, since there is a connection between the first vertex of the first group and the second vertex of the second group. So if we do this for every single pair of vertices, we have an adjacency matrix. Let's go back to our grid question. Given our board, we can construct an adjacency matrix. Why is this useful? First, let's consider how we can store a given permutation of edges. So given black edges B of I, where we have I going from 1 through n, and white edges W of I, where I goes from 1 through n, we can store each permutation as a list of n numbers, where the ith number is which vertex W of J is connected to the vertex B of I. Let's simplify this by looking at an example. So consider the list 1, 2, 6, 4, 3, 7, 8, 5. So the first number is 1. So vertex B of 1 is connected to vertex W of 1. The next vertex is 2. So vertex B of 2 is connected to vertex W of 2. The next number is 6. So vertex B of 3 is connected to vertex W of 6. And so on. Now, how do we tell if a given state of list of n numbers is a perfect match? Well, we need all of the edges represented by our list to be present. That means their value in the adjacency matrix has to be 1. So a better way to write this is that the product of all a of I, comma l of I, where l is our list of numbers, has to be equal to 1. And this makes sense, right? Because if any of the values in this product is equal to 0, the entire thing is equal to 0. And now we can write a quite general formula for a t of m comma n function. If you remember, the original question is asking how many ways can we arrange 2x1 dominoes and an m by n grid. And our function t of m comma n is the answer to this question for two inputs m and n. Our formula t of m comma n can be defined as follows. So we go through every single possible permutation of the list of n numbers, and we sum our product over all the values of a through which that list defines. So it's just a of I comma l of I for every single permutation of the list of n numbers. Now, if any of you have taken a linear algebra class before, you might recognize this formula. It's the permanent of a matrix. I'll leave a few links in the description to some resources you can use to learn up about this. Now we've simplified our question to this. Given two numbers m and n, find the adjacency matrix A and calculate the permanent of A. Now the main issue is that computing permanent of A is incredibly difficult. We are iterating through every single possible permutation, which takes exponential time. But if you notice, the formula for the permanent of this matrix is very similar to that of the determinant of a matrix, which looks like this. And the determinant of a matrix can be calculated in polynomial time, or O of n cubed. Now we can simplify our question even more. Find some matrix A hat for which the absolute value of the determinant of the matrix A hat is equal to the permanent of our matrix A. And so the value of our solution is just determinant of A hat. Well, this is still really hard, but let's take a slightly different approach to solving this. But let's define a function sigma, which takes an edge from our graph and assigns it either a positive value or a negative value. In this case, we'll just do positive 1 and negative 1. This, in graph theory, we call signing. And this results in a signed graph. When we apply this to our matrix, we get a signed adjacency matrix, A sigma. If such a function sigma exists, such that the permanent of an adjacency matrix, A, is equal to the absolute value of the determinant of our signed matrix, A sigma, we call this a Castellan signing of our graph. Let's consider an example. So let's consider a 2x3 grid. And if you remember in the beginning, since one of our sides is 2, we know that the number of ways to arrange 2x1 dominoes is just the n plus 1 Fibonacci number, which is the 4th Fibonacci number, which happens to be 3. And so we know that the permanent of our adjacency matrix is 3. So let's try weighting the graphs. So for this example, I'll just tell you how to weight it. So let's weight the leftmost edge and the rightmost edge, negative 1, and the rest 1. So if we calculate our signed adjacency matrix, we get this. And the determinant of this is negative 3. And the absolute value of that is 3, which is the permanent of our unsigned matrix. Now the question is, how do we find this signing function sigma? Well, it turns out that if our graph is planar, we can always calculate the signing function sigma in O of mn time. And a planar graph is pretty straightforward. It just means that none of the edges in the graph intersect with each other. And our grid graph is planar since none of the edges intersect with each other. So we've narrowed down our problem even further to finding the signing function sigma. How do we do this? The answer lies within the FKT algorithm, which is developed in 1967. But before I cover that, let's learn a little bit more about graphs. So a cycle of a graph, as the name suggests, is just a collection of vertices that returns back to the same vertex, like a cycle. Here's an example of a cycle on our graph. Notice, if our graph is bipartite, the cycle always has a length that's even. Let's learn some more terminology. A cycle is called evenly placed if the graph has a perfect matching when you remove that cycle from the graph. If you remember, a perfect matching is a collection of edges that covers every single vertex on the graph. So what I mean is, if you take the cycle and remove all the edges from that cycle, the remaining graph still has a perfect matching. Let's consider our signing function sigma. The cycle of a graph is properly signed if the number of negative edges has the opposite parity of the number of positive edges. What this means is that if I have an even number of positive edges in my cycle, the number of negative edges is odd and vice versa. Here's a fact. If every single evenly placed cycle in a graph is perfectly signed, then our signing function which we use to calculate this, sigma, is a Castellan signing of the entire graph. If you remember, a Castellan signing just means that the absolute value of the determinant of our signed adjacency matrix, A sigma, is equal to the permanent of the adjacency matrix, A. Now let's take advantage of the fact that our graph is planar. First, let's learn a little bit more about planar graphs. Like three-dimensional objects, we have three things: vertices, edges, and faces. And after I made this connection to three-dimensional objects, you probably remember Euler's formula, which is V plus F minus E is equal to 2. There are two types of faces. We have inner faces and outer faces. Suggested by the name, the inner faces are the ones that are bounded by edges of the graphs. The outer face is just the rest of the plane. Now let's consider another fact. For our special grid graph, let's consider all the inner faces of that graph. And let's look at the cycles that bound that face. If each of these cycles that bound the face is properly signed, which if you remember, that means that the number of positive and negative edges have opposite parity. Then the signing function that was used to calculate this signing is a Castellan signing of the whole graph. Now we've transformed our whole question into finding a function that satisfies this above property. To do this, we go back to recursion. So let's use the variable g. So we'll set g of 1 to the original graph. G of I plus 1 can be defined as deleting an edge, E of I, such that we remove a face, F of I, from the inner face and merge this face with the outer face. So let's keep doing this until we have no inner faces. Then we weigh all the remaining edges to positive 1. After that, we just work backwards. So we consider the last edge we removed and we add it back. And since we're adding one more inner face, we can weigh this edge such that the inner face has a boundary cycle that's perfectly signed. So for example, if we have an even number of negative edges and an even number of positive edges, we just like add one positive edge because it's going to make the parity the opposite of the other one. And then we keep on doing this for every single edge. And basically the signing function satisfies a property that we defined above. And we're done. So let's go back to the original problem statement and define the solution. Remember, the original question is how many ways can we perfectly arrange 2x1 dominoes on an m by n grid? So to solve this, we define a function t of m, n, which takes the dimensions of a grid m and n and gives the answer to this. So okay, the first step is to construct our planar graph on the grid. Then we remove the edges from our graph till we have only one face on our graph, the outer face. After that, we work backwards and insert the remaining edges, signing each edge such that the boundary cycle of the face is perfectly signed. Then, let's find the signed adjacency matrix A sigma. And finally, the answer to our original question is just the determinant of A sigma. This solution runs in polynomial time, O of mn. I've written up a solution to solve this question, and I've left a link to my code in the description for you to check out. Now I'm sure you're wondering where pi comes into this. There is, in fact, a closed form that's non-recursive solution to this question. Notice, the solution is a product of n numbers over a product of m numbers, so our solution is O of m times n. Also, if you notice, this closed form involves pi. Where does this come from? This comes from a way to solve recursive definitions of functions to find a closed form. The derivation is quite intricate and way too boring for this video, so I've just left a link to it in the description if you're interested. Before I go, I want to make a few announcements. I've launched my website at vcubingx.com, and it's pretty basic right now. I'll be adding more stuff, and there's already a store with a few products. Thanks for watching.